Hi everyone and welcome. This is the Apostate Prophet and I'm here with the first episode of this new show called The Apostates. This is a show that I have been planning for quite a long time and I want this to be great. And because I want this to be great, I thought my first guest should be someone whom I enjoyed talking to previously very, very much. Hello, Yasmin. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be your first guest.
It's great to have you. My guest is Yasmin Mohammed. Yasmin Mohammed is an ex-Muslim, just like me and so many others out there. Yasmin Mohammed also recently published a book that about which I definitely want to tell everyone here. The book is Unveiled. I have it with me. It's called Unveiled, How Western Liberals Empower Radical Islam. So first off, it's a very provocative subtitle. Why did you do that?
I wanted to get to the heart of the matter. I wanted to, to be perfectly honest, it was through a very long process of Sam Harris and I texting back and forth, back and forth. He actually came up with the final one that we both went, yes, that's it. That encompasses everything. Because there's so much that I want to say in the book, and it's really hard to find a subtitle that, that just concentrates everything that I want to say into a concise statement. So this book is my memoir. So it tells my story of my life. But through telling that story, it's also telling the story of so many other people like you and like other ex-Muslims, specifically ex-Muslim women, because we share a lot of experiences. So it's not just about me. And then it talks about how, because of the situations that have happened to me, what I'm highlighting is the misunderstanding that's going on in the Western world. So because I was born and raised in the West, but essentially going to Islamic schools, essentially living under Sharia law in Canada, I feel like I have one foot in each one of those different worlds. And also I lived in Muslim majority countries for 10 years. So I also have experience living in places like Egypt and Qatar. So I want to sort of bridge that gap. There's a lot of misunderstanding going on. There are a lot of blatant lies going on. And I just wanted to join in the conversation and offer my perspective. So as you'll know when you read the book, the catalyst, the whole reason why I started writing the book was because of the 2014 episode of Real Time with Bill Maher, where Ben Affleck was on the episode. Yeah, the famous episode with Ben Affleck and Sam Harris. And after that episode, my Facebook page was filled with people that were supporting Ben Affleck and who were angry at Sam Harris. And I realized, mea culpa, like these are my friends. I had never said a word about my life. I never said a word about how I grew up. And I felt guilty. Like I felt bad that they were all of these misinformed people that are so close to my life, people that I'd known sometimes 15, 20 years, and they were so misinformed on this topic. And so that's what made me decide that I wanted to start getting involved and to tell my side of the story. Yeah, no, so that was it. So that was the catalyst for the book. And so basically with this book, I'm hoping to speak to the liberal world, the Western world, the so-called enlightened world, and ask them to question, to question their own hypocrisy, to look at what they're doing and why they're doing it. And I'll give you one example of, how I'm sort of combining both my story and this polemic. When I was 13 years old, I went to one of my teachers and I told him about how I was being physically abused at home. And that abuse was usually around, you're too Western, you're not memorizing enough Quran, you missed, Sunnah after your prayers, like just, is usually related to things like that because I grew up in a fundamentalist Islamic family. So when I went to the teacher, my teacher, Mr. Fabro, who wrote the foreword for my book, when I went to him and I told him about the abuse that was going on at home, he alerted the authorities and he got the police involved and child services, and it went to family court. And the judge ended up saying, because of the culture that you're from, if this is the way your family chooses to discipline you, then that's their right. So essentially, he was engaging in cultural relativism, where he was telling me, because you've had the bad luck of being born to an Arab Muslim family, you must endure.
This is crazy.
Had you been a white girl with blonde hair from a family from Germany, then I would have protected you. But I'm not going to protect you because you come from this culture. And so that is an example of how Western liberals support radical Islam. So they are supporting the oppression of people like me, who are the minorities within the minorities. And there are so many examples of that happening. Another one is FGM in the UK. One case every hour is recorded of FGM in the United Kingdom. And it's been against the law for 30 years there, and nobody has ever been prosecuted. And that's because they don't want to say anything to the families because they don't want to come off as being gross and racist. And so what are they doing? They're leaving girls to continue to be mutilated with razors.
Isn't it
So
incredible?
even though it is incredible, but they're not actively protecting their own values. And so when they do that, even though they're not purposefully supporting radical Islam, they are supporting it by not speaking out against it and by not standing up against it. So when somebody says, "Oh, I cut my daughter's clitoris because I'm Muslim," the answer should be, "I don't care. You are now going to prison because you mutilated a helpless child."
There are two things here. I mean, one thing is that the same people who keep telling us that that Muslims and Islam are a part of this country or this culture or the West or whatever, the same people who tell us that also treat such situations like a foreign issue, which is why we cannot intervene in this. So there is a great cognitive dissonance going on
Absolutely.
in
And
this
people
case.
like me and you get stuck in the middle. We're the ones that fall through the cracks. It's like, what about me? Am I not Westerner? Am I not included? Well, how come I don't get to be protected? I mean, it doesn't matter. Human beings should be protected, but I'm a Canadian and I'm a Canadian citizen. And why am I not being protected just like every other Canadian? So to me, that's essentially racism. Like, that's
It is.
institutionalized racism. You're treating me less. You're treating me differently. You're leaving me to be abused because of where my family is from, and you would never do that to another girl who comes from a different family.
Absolutely. We have these especially in today's time, we see everywhere that great companies, individuals, the media, wherever you look, these talking points of liberating minorities or women or disadvantaged groups and this and that, all these social justice issues, these matters are constantly raised everywhere in the West. When it comes to the own culture, we constantly have to talk about going forward, about progressivism, about standing up to unfair behavior that comes from traditions from our past, about manifest behavior that is toxic. But when we talk about a different culture, when we talk about Islamic, when we talk about Muslim culture, when we talk about yours or my culture, we suddenly don't want to talk about these things because that is somehow racism or Islamophobic or intolerant, or because we don't understand that culture. This is
Exactly. So what you're doing is you're condemning those cultures to never progress.
absolutely.
You're saying the only cultures that are allowed to progress are Western cultures. All the rest of you have to stay with your ancient barbaric ideas because they're cute and quaint and they're like noble savages. You guys, we want you to stay like that. Stay wearing your niqabs because it's empowering and liberating. But for us, No, no, we want equality and we want progress and we want women to be able to free the nipple if they want to. But that's for
but
us. We get to progress. You guys can't. Yeah. Yeah. Because if we start to talk about that, then that's racist. But yeah, how can anything progress if you can't criticize it? Criticism is the first step. Recognizing that there's a problem here and recognizing that it needs to be fixed. But if every time you try to say there's a problem here and other people jump up and say that's Islamophobia, then it's never going to progress. It's never going to get any better as long as nobody wants to admit that there is a problem.
This always reminds me of white privilege. You know, when they say white privilege in a completely different context, of course, you know, that's, that we are advantaged and that other people are disadvantaged. The same people who often speak of white privilege are also those people who completely practice this white privilege in that they want their own culture to progress, but don't allow this different culture to make the same progress, to raise the same objections. That is white privilege. You know, I hate that
Absolutely.
Word. I absolutely hate that term, but that is white privilege. I'm sorry.
I mean, there's so many of these terms that they've invented, like internalized misogyny, white privilege, rape culture. So many of these things that they bring up and that they've clarified. And when they bring them up, I'm like, I don't really see that happening in your world, but that's definitely happening in my world. Yeah. Let me tell you how, you know, but they don't want to hear about that. They don't want to know that these things are actually real and true. You know, it's kind of like The Handmaid's Tale. They will talk about it. It's fictional women, fictional characters, a fictional world, you know, then they're happy to talk about it. But if I tell them, but what's even worse than that world is what's happening in Iran right now or happening in Saudi Arabia, like this is real life. They don't want to talk about real life.
It is. There's also
they
the problem.
They want to talk about.
Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
No, I was
no.
Gonna say...
Somebody on Twitter once said to me, "Oh, could we keep cutting
go,
each
go,
other?"
Go.
Somebody on Twitter once said to me, "They don't want to slay dragons; they want to swat at fruit flies," and that's exactly what it is. Okay. They don't want any real problems. When they talk about rape culture here in the West, they know that this isn't actually rape culture. Rape culture are the cultures that force women to cover themselves in black head to toe so that they don't get raped. Rape cultures are the ones that victim blame young girls, or the ones that slut shame women for not covering their hair, or the cultures that say girls that don't cover themselves are free to be raped. It's the ones that cover themselves, you shouldn't rape them, okay? Cultures that say if you're gonna complain about being raped, then you are gonna be, you know, 100 stones or lashed, 100 lashings, unless you have 4 male witnesses to the penetration.
Yeah.
That's a rape culture.
That is rape culture. I found my wife was fascinated by your book. When she ordered it first, it arrived, she started reading it. She started telling me about it. And it was quite shocking. I was much less shocked because I'm quite familiar with that, but I was still, to a certain extent, shocked. You wrote a lot about how you, as a woman under Islam, under this Islamic system, this Islamic mentality, went through abuse. As far as I remember, you were at some point basically pretty much forcibly married, right?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. How did that happen? How did that occur?
So that was a very, you know, long, tiring process. Ever since I graduated from high school, so I graduated at 17, and immediately my mom tried to get me married off to my first cousin, and that didn't work. And so then they tried with my second cousin, and that didn't work. And it was, I mean, a lot had been going on during these years. I don't know how much your wife told you, but, you know, my parents or my mom dropped me off in Egypt. She didn't even say anything to me. I just woke up in the morning and my family were all gone back to Canada and she'd left me in Egypt because she just couldn't handle me anymore. I was too much trouble, which is just a joke because I hadn't even kissed a boy. I hadn't had a sip of alcohol. I never went out without my hijab on. Like, I didn't do anything. I was a perfect girl, but it was too much. She couldn't handle me, so she dropped me off in Egypt. So my relationship with my mother was really, really contentious. And I just started to get really tired, and I just wanted her approval. And just the constant pressure, pushing, 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 marry this man, marry this man, marry this man. You won't be my daughter anymore if you don't marry him. I want nothing to do with you if you don't marry him. I don't even want you to come to my funeral. I'm going to kick you out of the house. It was just a lot of threats, especially the biggest one was, you will never go to heaven because you know the hadith about heaven being at the feet of your mother's. So the mother gets to decide if you're going to go to heaven or not. And so she's telling me, you're never going to even smell the air from heaven. I'll make sure that you burn in hell for eternity for not marrying this man. So all sorts of threats, and also just me being worn down. I was tired. And I said to myself at that point, I said, you know what? What if I just try it her way? What if I just do what she says? Maybe it won't be so bad. Let's see. I'll marry him, and worst comes to worse, I could end up with a little baby and divorced. At least I get a baby. That's, like I was immature. And I have so many people, by the way, that are sending me messages and tweeting and that are feeling the exact same way, that say the exact same words, like, if I just do it, then maybe they'll stop. And in fact, there's a campaign in Australia where they're trying to help girls that are being pulled into forced marriages. And that's one of the things that they say. One of the coercive messages that's coming from a family member is saying, if you just marry him, then they'll stop. And I remember thinking that, like, if I just marry him, then she'll stop pressuring me. And so I married him. And it's not like it mattered anyway. Again, in Islam, a woman's silence means consent. So I just sat there. I never even nodded my head. And I was Islamically married. Magic, right? The woman, your input is irrelevant. So I ended up married to him, and I did end up having a little daughter, so that was the best part, the only good part of the marriage. And as you know, I was contacted by the Canadian CIA, CSIS, to tell me that the man I was married to was a member of Al Qaeda, and he's working with Bin Laden. So that was motivating for me to get myself and my daughter away from him.
How much did you know of that? I mean, I don't know if we can talk about this, but how much did you know of that? That's what you were told about him being a member of the organization?
So how much did I know before they told me? So I knew that he had been in Afghanistan before he came to Canada, because he entered Canada with a fake Saudi Arabian passport from Afghanistan. So an Egyptian flying into Canada from Afghanistan with a fake Saudi Arabian passport, that's a lot of issues there. That's a lot of red flags. So it
Strange.
turns It's strange, yeah. He went to prison right away because they realized that this was a fake passport, and of course that's a criminal offense. And the money was actually sent to him from Bin Laden himself to bail him out of prison and to pay for his lawyer. And we know this now because it's all online, right? He was part of a very big court case in Egypt. In fact, it was the second largest court case in Egyptian history related to terrorism, the first one being the assassination of Anwar Sadat. So if you Google his name, there's lots of information out there, lots of articles out there about him, and that's how I learned most of the things about him was through reading what other journalists had discovered about him. But I knew that he had been in Afghanistan before he came to Canada, and my mom told me that he was there driving the Red Crescent, like basically he was an ambulance driver. He was saving lives.
That is
And
the irony, yeah.
I knew something was up because who goes to Afghanistan from Egypt unless you're a jihadi, right? But I didn't know the extent that he was involved in terrorism until I was contacted by CSIS.
It is interesting. I mean, you're talking directly from the experience with the experience of someone who I would say experienced the most extreme part of this whole culture that we are dealing with, of this whole ideology that we are dealing with. I also don't want to call it extreme because if I call it extreme, it kind of sounds like I'm just putting it into the corner of extreme, and it has nothing to do with the rest. But I really don't want to make it that way because the thing is, we have just talked about how you were basically forced into a marriage. You know, you were basically pushed into it. You were mistreated during all of that, and the guy turned out to be part of a terrorist organization and all that stuff. Some people would raise the objection, of course, and would say, well, that has nothing to do with Islam because some of these things are not permitted in Islam, or some of these things are, you know, Islam is not directly responsible for them. But I always like to say in such a case, many of these things are directly influenced by Islam. And even if these things were not completely in alignment with Islam, the problem is that these things are issues that exist in Islamic culture. These are issues that exist there, not here. These are issues that exist in Egypt or in Afghanistan, in all these cultures, and not in not among white Christians or atheists or Jews or whatever in America. You know, these issues are part of that culture, are part of our past, which is why we are here talking about them.
Yeah, and it's back to what we were saying in the beginning with if you can't criticize something, then how do you expect it to progress? Or basically, if you don't criticize it, it can never progress. So what we are talking about here is the fact these are not, if these were only cultural issues, then they would be able to progress. They would be able to change over time. But what is keeping them fossilized into, 1400 years ago is the religion.
It
That's
is.
the reason why it can't move forward and why these things can't change. So when we talk about child marriage, for example, in Iran, they were trying to bring down the age of consent for, or sorry, bring up the age so that young girls couldn't be married off. And in the end, it was not allowed to pass because they said that it would be un-Islamic. And the same thing happened in Pakistan when they were trying to change the age for girls to get married. They didn't allow it because they said it would be un-Islamic. So that's where Islam comes into play here. And it takes the culture and it makes sure that it stays 1400 years ago.
Well, child marriage is absolutely part of Islam. There is just no doubt about it. I even had a I had a recent Muslim apologist who liked to kind of refute my work, who basically told me publicly that it is not child rape, that it is not a violation of a child, because how is it child rape if there is parental consent? If the parents consent to it, then how is it child rape? That's basically an excuse. That's a response that I recently received from a Muslim apologist who really means it, you know, and who is a scholar in Islamic matters. This is
There
completely
are
Islamic.
actually, There are parents that rape their children. Like, has he never
Yeah,
heard of
yeah,
fathers
yeah.
that rape their own daughters?
Yeah.
So is that okay then because the father approved
Absolutely. What
it?
kind of logic is that? The point stands. I mean, that is entirely Islamic. I made huge series, huge videos and articles about how child marriage comes from Islam. It comes directly from the Prophet of Islam, who, when he was 53 years old, was married to a 9-year-old girl, whom he married when she was only 6 years
Actually,
old.
six.
Yeah, and he.
So the everything you're saying is true. And you were brought up, like you're Turkish, brought up in Germany. My family is Egyptian and Palestinian, brought up in Canada. Why do we have these common experiences? We don't
That's why.
share culture. We don't share the same
We
culture.
don't. We don't.
We share the same religion. So for people to say that this was that these are just cultural issues and that they didn't have to do with the religion, well then why are they happening in all of these different countries that do not share the language, do not share the food, do not share anything in common except for their religion? And even violence, when we talk about jihadis, people like to say, oh no, these are just bad men. They're not, it has nothing to do with religion. It's exactly the opposite. I mean, I'll talk about my ex specifically with him. He was 14 years old and through for, different reasons, he didn't get along with his peers at school. And so he was outcast. He was an outsider. And he was recruited by the jihadis to join, like, oh, don't worry about these boys. You're going to join us, and you're going to be a real man, and you're going to go to, this level of heaven that these boys will never be able to go to because you're going to be a jihadi and you're going to get 72 virgins and you're going to be hanging out with the prophets, drinking rivers of alcohol and honey and whatever. And they put all of these ideas into his head, and they made him think that murdering people is the best possible use of his life. He thought he was being good. He didn't think he was being evil. He thought that he was doing what's best for this planet. And why did he think that? Because of Islam. It's always the bottom line.
You know, the funny thing is, to the outside, it just appears all so innocent, which is why people, Muslims in the West and Western people and non-Muslims assume that all this entire problem of Islamic violence was just something that we could trace back to extremism or taking the religion out of context, because people don't really see the inside of the Muslim community. They don't really see how things go in the Islamic world. I can think of myself, for example, or of my family. We were in Germany. You know, we lived in Germany, and from the outside, all that people saw was just that my family were nice people, a nice family. You know, people who smile, people who are friendly, who are totally polite. I'm just a little bit different. All that is different about me is that I come from a different culture. I believe in a different religion, but I would be in no ways involved in any hateful thoughts. But on the inside, we learned very clear things. On the inside, I learned that the only reason we don't go out and wage active war with weapons in the name of Allah, for Allah, is that it is currently not the right time. We are currently at the wrong time. We might wait for something to happen, for the Mahdi, the awaited savior, to come and to lead us to war against the infidel, or something great might happen. The Western infidels might attack us, but it is currently just not the right time, and that is why we are currently in peace. On the inside, that is exactly what was happening. And from the outside, you would just say, oh, these are just friendly people. All that is different about them is that they believe in Islam, which is just a different religion.
I was taught the same thing, and I was taught that it was when the caliphate rises, when the Islamic State rises, and then we become powerful, and then we can, fight back against these infidels. So that's why when the Islamic State rose in Syria and Iraq, what happened? kids from all over the world, all over Europe, all over North America. It was almost just like something snapped, and immediately they all went over there. How do you think they got radicalized so quickly? Because they had already been radicalized. They had already been told, they'd been given these messages, and they'd been told, you just wait for the day, and when the day comes, you have to be prepared to go and fight. And so the day came, and they went, and they burned their passports, and they joined the Islamic State, just like they were told to do.
And quite regular, quite normal people. You have known them. I have known them. People that we just knew as normal, regular believers, maybe devout or pious believers, or people who are not even that great, you know, when it comes to practicing Islam. Just people who believe in this, who suddenly
In
started
fact, it was
flocking.
sometimes like I know of some people that, a guy that was gay, and because he felt so much self-hate over being gay, he felt like the only way that I can absolve myself of this sin is to go and die fi sabilillah, and then Allah will forgive me for being, a filthy homosexual.
For the sake of Allah.
So in some ways, it can even affect those who are not even religious at all, but who are feeling so much guilt over that. And so then they want to go and kill themselves or, take infidels with them, hopefully, when they die. So that way they can absolve themselves of that guilt. So it is really hard to tell. I mean, another example is the Florida guy who shot up the Pulse nightclub. He wasn't very religious. His wife didn't wear hijab. It's hard to tell from the outside. But, when you are taking these ideas and you are preaching them, from this book, you're preaching it to 1.7 billion people. A certain percentage of those people are going to internalize those ideas, and they're going to respond to those ideas, and they're going to take action the way this book asks them to take action. A certain, I mean, even if it's 1 or 2%, that's millions of people, right? Like, we don't, th this is a very dangerous thing to be teaching this ideology and then just hoping that nobody actually listens to it. It's a spectrum. We talked about, you were talking about extremism. It's a spectrum. Islam is one religion, but Muslims practice it on a spectrum. Anywhere from over here, whereas this guy sleeps around and drinks alcohol, but he just doesn't eat pork. And he hates Jews,
Always.
so he's still a Muslim. And then all the way to the other side is basically ISIS. But that's what Islam is. If you continue with Islam, if you continue studying it and you continue following it and you follow the fundamentalism of it, the fundamentals, you will reach ISIS. That's where you will be. That's what it's asking you to do.
And as you said, people who are gay or who are sinful and who feel bad about themselves, who think they can find salvation in going and fighting for Allah, these people don't just get this idea by themselves. They don't just come up with this crazy idea. That's not how it works. If you grow up as a Muslim, if you grow up with Muslim culture and you grow up with these Islamic stories, even as a little child, you learn these things. You learn that that Muhammad and his wonderful, great, amazing companions would sacrifice themselves for the sake of Allah. They would go and fight and die for Allah. You don't at that age,
They're
in fact, nowhere.
superheroes.
You don't learn anywhere that they were just doing it for defense. That's not what you learn. You learn that they were fighting for the sake of Allah and they were just wanting to die for the sake of Allah. That is what you learn. It's full of stories, full of sources where Muhammad's followers, where Muhammad's loyal companions tell him, "I wish I could die for Allah. I wish I could die for you." And this is where people get this idea from. They don't just get this from some extremist corner or from some crazy thinking. That's not how it works.
And I think Sam Harris had a really great example when he was talking about how people like to say that none of this has anything to do with Islam. These people are just psychopaths. They just wanted to murder people or whatever. And he said, you don't use that same logic when you talk about a Jehovah's Witness mother, for example, that allows her daughter to die because she didn't want to give her a blood transfusion. We understand that this mother is not a psychopath and that she actually secretly wanted to murder her daughter, so she's just using the religion as an excuse. We would never say that about her.
No.
But when it comes to jihadis, for some reason, we say that about them.
Yeah.
We say that these men are actually just psychopaths. And there's nothing wrong with Islam. They're twisting the religion because they actually just want to kill people, and they're using this as an excuse.
Yep.
Well, why are we allowing, you know, why are we accepting that this Jehovah's Witness woman is a normal human being who is indoctrinated in this, you know, this terrible edict that's telling her that she should allow her daughter to die? We recognize that she is a good person that has been poisoned by a bad ideology. But why don't we recognize that about Arab or Pakistani or Afghani or all of those other people all over the rest of the world? Why don't we recognize that they're good people poisoned by a insidious ideology?
Yeah.
Why do we instead say, no, they're just bad people?
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with the ideology. Why do we flip it around like that?
The funny thing is, just a reminder, I think it was just yesterday or a few days ago, I saw a news article from the Associated Press, I believe, which was about this family, this Mormon, fundamentalist Mormon family, or a compound, where several women and children were killed by a drug cartel. And this landed on the Associated Press with an article that was titled in something like that this incident makes the Mormon Church confront their history of polygamy, you know, in kind of a very critical way, this article. When do we ever see something like that about Islam, you know, when this
mm-hmm.
happens? When do we ever see that? Why do we not see that? When I was growing up in Germany, Germans had this expectation of Muslims, of us, that we should integrate into society. You know, they kind of had this feeling that that they need to fix our behavior, that they need to, you know, that we need to adjust, you know, that we need to adapt. It increasingly feels like that has been lost. They just don't know how to deal with this anymore, and so they think, well, we can't fix these people, so we just need to tolerate them, and we just need to put all those bad things into the corner and ignore them.
That's the cultural relativism. That's the problem. I mean, I was one of my good friends. He's a first generation Italian. His family is from Sicily, and he talks about, you know, his father, or could, you know, he couldn't beat up his mother in the streets because the other Canadians would be like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
That's you. We don't do that here. You know, this isn't Italy. You can't get away with that here. Or whatever it was, like the rest of the Canadian society would push his family to integrate into this new culture with new values, new expectations, new boundaries. Of course, they weren't happy about some of the things. They liked the way it was in their old world, the way they did things. But they had to understand, we're in a new country now, and these are the values here, and these are the laws here, and these are the rules here.
Yeah.
That wasn't my experience. That's not the way it was for me. For me, it was the exact opposite. For me, whatever, like my mom felt like royalty walking around Canada with a hijab on
mm-hmm.
because she could demand whatever she wanted
yep.
to demand, and everybody would just fall to her feet because they're too scared to say anything to her lest they be called gross and racist,
yep.
right?
Yep.
So she was never asked to conform to society. And like that example I gave earlier on in our interview, even when she was hanging me upside down in the garage and whipping me, that wasn't enough for our Canadian judicial system to say to her, that's not allowed. You can't do that. Maybe you can do that in your country back home and get away with it, but you can't do that here. That's all we're asking. We're just at, like, why aren't we treated just like everybody else? They think that by treating us differently, they're doing us a favor by saying, no, 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 we accept you for who you are. You're not doing anybody a favor because you can't accept people for who they are when those people sometimes hate gay people.
Yeah.
or want to marry off their underage daughters, or want to cut off her clitoris, or want to beat her up. You know what I mean? Like, you can't just automatically accept people because of the culture that they come from, and regardless of if the things that they want to do are against your values or even against your laws. You have to stay firm and say, no, 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 these are our values, these are our laws. If you want to abide by them, welcome. If you don't want to abide by them, then you're going to have to pay the consequences. We don't have any stop signs. We don't have any boundaries. We don't have any, there's no borders. They just let people do whatever they want to do as long as they have brown skin.
Okay, Yasmin, why do you hate Muslims so much?
Oh my God!
The thing is, I have to bring this up. Now, when we talk like this, we talk about how quite regular Muslims end up following a very violent idea, going into a very violent form of Islam. I hate saying that, and they we talk about these common Muslim problems among Muslim society, problems of child abuse, of domestic violence among Muslim families, and all these things. So when we talk about these things, it appears to some people like we are being hateful of Muslims, and the regular Western person, the regular Ben Affleck, then goes, "That's gross. It's racist." But you don't hate Muslims.
When we talk about these things, why would I care about these things if I didn't care about the human beings that are being affected by it? When I talk about women being imprisoned in Iran for taking off their hijab, or women imprisoned in Saudi Arabia because they're talking about feminism, or because they want the right to drive or to abolish gender apartheid. These are Muslim women. You know what I mean? Like, if I didn't care about women in those societies or about people in those societies, then I wouldn't care. I wouldn't talk about it. When I talk about 15 Muslim majority countries will execute you for being gay, why am I talking about that? I'm not gay. I'm not Muslim. Why do I care? Because I care about those human beings. That's why. You know, like it's just so nonsensical to me. And that's the kind of criticism that comes from the white liberal left.
Yeah.
Because Muslims more often than not recognize that these are problems. You know, very often they don't like, especially Arabs, they don't like to air their dirty laundry.
Yeah.
You know, it's part of Arab culture that you just, no matter what kind of filth is going on in your house, that does not leave your front door.
Yeah.
You know, it's shameful. We have to always be viewed. We want people to always view us as, you know, Saudi Arabians legitimately think that everybody wants to be like them. They really believe that everybody wishes that they could be Saudi Arabian living in Saudi Arabia. They really genuinely believe this because they think that that's the impression that they're giving off to the world and that the world is buying it, you know? And so it's very shameful to talk about all of the bad things that happen in those societies. So I understand from that point of view that they don't like us to talk about these things. But at the same time, they understand that these are problems because they're the ones that are living in it. I'm not even living in it. I'm free. I'm happy. I'm married to a white non-Muslim man. You know what I mean? I have two beautiful daughters that are free. I'm a tenured professor at college. I'm not doing any of this for myself. I am doing this to speak up for the people that are living the life that I used to live. And when I was living it, nobody was there talking about it. I did not see anyone talking about these things. I didn't hear any voices. Salman Rushdie's voice came out for a very limited amount of time before the fatwa was on his head, you know. But other than that, you know, what did we hear about? We heard about Cat Stevens wanting Salman Rushdie dead. And it was like a tsunami of people against Salman Rushdie. We didn't have any of these ex-Muslim voices that we have now that are speaking up and speaking about these problems. They didn't exist.
Yeah.
And I felt alone and I felt like I was crazy, and I felt like there was something wrong with me, that I had a problem with the fact that a 53-year-old man would marry a 6-year-old girl, for one example, or what's wrong with me that I have a problem that Allah would tell his men that if you fear obedience from your wives, beat them. Why do I have a problem with that? And nobody else does. Everybody else seems to think this is perfectly normal, you know? And so now to have other voices come out there and to support each other and to all say, yes, there's something wrong with that. We have to deal with this problem. This is not weak. This is unacceptable. A lot of those people that are saying that are Muslims.
Yep. Yep.
And they're on our side. They don't like the fact that we're ex-Muslims, of course, but they agree with a lot of the things that we have to say. And having said that, there are a lot of Muslim reformers like, you know, Majid Nawaz and Raheel Reza and Nasr Nomani, et cetera, that are supportive of ex-Muslims too, and that say, you're allowed to believe whatever you want to believe. You're still part of our community and you always will be. And then there's people in my family that treat me that way too. One, but still it exists. You know, there are people that can be, that are Muslim and that are still open-minded and allow people to be free thinkers. That's not hard to find in a Christian community. That's not hard to find in a Jewish community. But to find it in a Muslim community is like a diamond in the rough.
Times are changing too. I mean, I think about my own family. I only recently came out, if I can say that, to my own family. I recently visited them, went to Turkey and told them about everything, about how I don't believe in Islam, briefly why I don't believe in Islam, that I'm doing all of this publicly. I don't know why it took so long for them to find out. The YouTube channel has become huge. I used to be so scared of what my father would think of anything, you know, when I was a Muslim and when I did something wrong or said something wrong. You just grew up with this fear of your father and of the elders and all that stuff. And of course, they didn't take it very well, learning that I am not a Muslim, that I don't follow this religion anymore, that I am against it. They didn't take it well. But I was in a way surprised that it looks like it didn't kill them. Mm-hmm. Because it seemed different 20 years ago. It would have been probably different 50 years ago. It would have been completely different 100 years ago. I learned of older relatives and family members that went a different way, that just went a different way in politics, or that moved to a different country and made different marriages, who are now completely rejected and condemned. But I survived it, you know. So times are changing, and the thing is, we are also the ones who are helping drive this change. We are also the ones, trying to help our cultures, trying to help our Muslim communities make this progress. We have always learned from history that that your culture needs criticism and exposure to mistakes and improvements in order to become better. These cultures will never change if you constantly tell them that they are completely fine, that they are perfect, that they don't need any criticism at all, that they are doing nothing wrong. That won't change them for the better. We can only change them by revealing what is wrong about them. And that's what we are doing. And we're not doing this because we are hating people. You and I, we receive so many contacts, so many messages from people who have let go of their Islamic beliefs because of us, or have come across us, have started listening to us, have started changing their minds, even if they didn't leave their religion. And we embrace these people. We don't hate them. What we hate is what we were indoctrinated with, and how we were brought up, and how our past was, and this past also leaves its mark on us. And we talked about this briefly before we started recording. I mentioned to you that I went through a phase of anxiety and that I'm kind of still going through it. You mentioned that you had similar problems because of our past, and because the past leaves its mark on us. Not only mentally, but also on just on our entire system. Wouldn't you agree?
No, I absolutely agree. We have been through trauma, essentially. We have been through trauma. We had our entire world ripped apart. It's like the movie The Truman Show. Everything that we thought was true, everything that we believed, all of our thoughts and hopes and ideas and everything about us was completely demolished. And then we just had, we had to pick up the pieces. We found ourselves standing in the middle of chaos and we had to rebuild our lives brick by brick. Now, people like you and me had to do that. It was so lonely for us because you have to do it while keeping your mouth shut because you're also scared that if you the wrong person hears about what you've just done, that they're going to want to kill you. And of course, the people living in Muslim majority countries, it's even worse for them. But still, even for me here in the Western world, that was an incredibly dark, scary, lonely time. And I say this, with 100% certitude. If I did not have a daughter that I needed to stay alive for, I would not be talking to you today. There is no way I would have survived that dark time. And there are a lot of people that had to leave their religions, like one woman who was leaving the Hasidic Jewish community, which is very insular and similar to our experiences. And when she left, she was essentially excommunicated, or leaving the Amish community, or Scientology. A lot of these religions do the same garbage where they just completely cut off the person if they're not going to join their cult. If you don't believe the same thing we believe, then we don't know you. You're not one of us anymore. And that is so dehumanizing and it is so diminishing. And for us to have survived that in the darkness and in the loneliness, of course we're going to reach back towards anybody who's going through this right now and say to them, you're not alone. And to try to turn on a light for them because we do not want one single human being to ever go through what we went through. And if there's anything that we can do to try and minimize that, to assist them and to support them, then we're going to do it. It doesn't matter how much hate they throw at me, doesn't matter how many death threats I get per day, I'm going to continue doing this because it heals me to help other people.
I'm glad you survived. You're doing amazing.
Thank you, you too.
Thank you. That's why I said it. I just wanted to hear you say that too. what is your advice to all those people who really who watch you and who listen to me and who just need some motivation, some advice, who are going through this hardship, who can't find a way out. What is your advice to these people?
The advice that I wish somebody had told me, and I probably wouldn't have believed them, but the advice that they need to hear right now is no matter how difficult your life is right now, no matter how much you think, I can't come out to my family, or I have to continue living this double life, or I have to hide my feelings. All of the torture that you're going through right now, people always think if I leave, if I become open, it's going to be worse. I'll lose my family, I'll lose my friends, I'll lose my community, I'll be all alone. All of that is true. But you will be so much happier. It's hard to believe that that's true. But it's like that example that you just gave about coming out to your parents. You dreaded it so much. And then when you did it, it's like this huge weight is lifted off your shoulders and you feel so much better now. And no bombs went off, nobody died. Everything turned out to be okay. It is so worth living a free, honest, true life regardless of the cost, because freedom is worth any cost. Now, of course, I say that, but I want people to be safe.
Yeah.
You know, so of course, be aware of your situation, be aware of your surrounding. I know a lot of people that pretend to be Muslim as they're saving money or as they're planning their exit. Do that. Be smart about it, but don't waste your life. I am so resentful over my youth being wasted praying to a figment of a goat herder's imagination. You know how angry that makes me feel?
I feel
that
the same.
Some illiterate idiot from the 6th century who sat in a cave and had hallucinations ended up controlling my life to the point that even though I left Islam 15 years ago, this anxiety and the panic attacks and the depression and the all of these things, they're still a part of me. I will never be free, you know, but all I can do is take comfort in knowing that my two daughters will never understand this life. They'll never be able to relate to this. And every single person that I reach out to online, you know, I take comfort in that at least all of this that I have been through is not for nothing.
Mm-hmm.
At least I can make something good come out of it as a result.
That is great. It is really very hard to imagine if you grow up with Islam and if you at some point end up being very devout, very religious, and being in love with this religion, with this God, because that's what you are so brutally indoctrinated with. And even if you love this Prophet Muhammad so much, which is a completely weird thing that people outside Islam don't understand, you are even loving this guy for some completely weird reason. It's like a weird gay story. I don't know, but
yeah, he gets worshipped more than Allah, actually.
People are mm-hmm. Muslims are much angrier about if you say something about Muhammad than if you say something about Allah. It is a very weird attitude. But if you tell them that this is a very cultish behavior, when Islam is definitely not supposed to be that way because it emphasizes tawhid, monotheism, so much, then they don't want to agree with that, and they think you're just being problematic. But yeah. it is insane that when you are that religious, you never think of, you can probably never imagine how great and how confident you will feel after you get out of the folds of Islam, and then you look back and you find it so damn ridiculous.
Yes, it's embarrassing.
Stupid, what you believed in, what you lived with. It is so.
I know.
I can't find the words.
I know. Yeah. And so the sooner people can get themselves out of that, and the more of their life that they have left over, the better. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, don't waste your time being stuck in limbo, questioning, on the fence, you know, living a double life, da da da. Just do it. Just follow your heart, follow your mind, follow honesty, follow truth, and just live your life. People are worried about, like, oh, but my parents aren't going to pay my tuition. Oh, but then, you know, I'm going to have to find my own house and pay my own rent. It's like, these are such trivial, stupid concerns. You know what I mean? I'm talking about the difference between being and sad and all of those things and liberty, freedom. You know, like there's no price that isn't worth it.
And do you really want to be held back? Do you really want to be held in a cage by such a system that controls you with fear? Even if you mm-hmm. are a complete believer in Islam, even if you can in no way relate to what I'm saying right now, you know deep inside that Islam controls you with fear. I mm-hmm. at some point I was so religious and I thought I will never ever leave this. I would rather die than being without this. And at that point, I was full of fear because Islam controlled me with fear. Even
after.
Yeah.
Even after I didn't believe anymore, I was still scared.
Yes, yes.
You know, like I truly didn't believe any of this stuff, but I was still scared that what if I'm wrong? And I know I'm not wrong. Of course, the creator of the universe would know that he didn't create it flat. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Of course Allah didn't write this book, if there is, you know, or whatever creator of the universe. I know that none of this is true, but I'm still scared that I'm going to burn in hell for eternity, because you're being told these things from when you're too young to even remember the first time you were being told it. So it's a part of your subconscious. It's so ingrained into you that it takes years to clean that indoctrination out of your mind.
Speaking of following a very weird goat herding merchant from the 7th century, what's your favorite thing about what's your favorite thing of all those great new things that you have after leaving Islam?
What's my favorite part of leaving Islam? My God, where do I begin? I think that my favorite part is being allowed to think, to be perfectly honest. Almost intoxicating for me. It was so beautiful to not have boundaries on my mind, but to be able to just continue with a thought and not be forced to stop, and not to have to do all of this pretzel gymnastics to try and make things like reality and Islam, and I'm trying to make these two things make sense together. And so much cognitive dissonance and all of that stuff, to just be free of all that and just be able to think, just be able to use my brain fully and wholly without restricting myself. Yeah.
My whole life was I'm starting a thought and then I think, oh, I can't go further.
Yes.
I can't do that.
Yes.
Stop. Think about something different.
Oh, my God. Yes.
And now
to the point that you stop thinking.
Yeah.
You're like, what's the point?
Yes.
I have to stop. This is just, it's useless. I'm just going to accept it. I'll just follow. I was even too afraid because I'm like, Allah can read my mind.
Yes.
So I can't even... I can't even question having that question. You know what I mean? You just have to, you stop the question before it starts, because you don't want to get yourself in trouble.
That's incredible. You have a lovely dog, right?
Yeah, I do. So no angels will ever enter this home.
That's one of the greatest things, aside from the whole thought and mentality stuff, of course. Having a dog is a fantastic thing.
Yeah.
Whenever I look at my dog, I feel so ridiculous about the restriction in Islam.
Yeah, I feel sorry for them, because dogs bring so much joy. Islam sucks the joy out, though, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Anything that is joy, music, haram. Relationships, haram, you know, everything, alcohol, haram, sex, haram, dogs, haram. Find anything that will bring you happiness, it's haram. And it's a miserable state to be in. And so, of course, you know, when you ask me what's the best part of leaving Islam, it's a difficult question, because there are so many good things. Like, I went from being angry and miserable and just not caring about my life. Okay, I'm going to tell you, that's a close number two, is actually enjoying life. Because as a Muslim, as you know, we're taught that this world is of no value. Our life is of no value. All that matters is al-akhirah. So we're living, waiting to die, you know? But to be able to stop and actually appreciate life and enjoy life, and not feel guilty about enjoying life. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, oh, those are dunya things. You shouldn't be concerned about that. You have to be concerned about al-akhirah all the time. It's like, no, I fucking love this dunya.
Yeah.
And I'm going to appreciate it. And I'm going to enjoy it. You know, it's wonderful to be able to embrace life as opposed to embracing death.
Thank you for bringing this up. This reminds me that I wanted to talk soon about, I'm probably going to make soon a video about how the Islamic world lacks productivity so much because of Islam. So wherever I went in, the Muslim world, people were just so unconcerned about productivity and about doing something useful because they were so obsessed with death and with the afterlife and with how everything is useless. Yeah. It is incredible. I remember so many scenes of just sitting together with random Muslims or with my family or with others and just out of nowhere mentioning how all of this is just temporary and we're going to die soon. And we have to think about that. Just shut the hell up.
Yeah.
One more thing I want to talk about is I talked about this a lot with you, but I think you have a lot of great stuff to say about this. But you might also just be tired of hearing this. But your story with the hijab, you wore the hijab, you wore it sometimes without even wanting to wear it, I think, toward the end. How did you feel with the hijab? How was it? How difficult was it to take it off? And how does it feel after it?
So the hijab to me is a physical representation of all of this subjugation and dehumanization and everything that we've been talking about for this. Yeah, that's a hijab being thrown to the ground. See, it's falling to the ground because I have been unveiled both literally and metaphorically. So literally unveiling my head, but also, you know, figuratively removing this veil of lies and allowing my mind to be free, letting my hair be free and letting my mind be free. So really that's what the hijab is. It restricts, it's the physical representation of all of those restrictions. If you can't control what goes on your head, you're not going to be able to control what goes in your head.
Perfect.
And so to me, the hijab was all of those things. And it had been put on me from 9 years old. There are a lot of girls that's put on them even younger than that. In Iran, you can't go to school unless you wear a hijab. So that's from 7 years old. And when you've been wearing it for that long, and then as an adult, and for me, I wore niqab too, which covered my face for many years. And it's like if you were to all of a sudden walk out the door without pants. That's what it would feel like for you, because all your life you've been wearing pants when you go out in public. And so to walk out in your underwear one day, you're going to feel strange. It was so weird to me that I was concerned that everybody was going to look at me.
Yeah.
Like I was with my friend and I'm like, I can't. Now this is about my face, right? Like this is about niqab. I didn't want to take it off. I'm like, everybody's going to look at me. You know, I'm going to feel weird. And she's like, why would they look at you? They would look at you if your face is covered. They're not going to look at you if your face is uncovered. Nobody's face is covered. And it's so weird to walk out into the world and literally nobody cares. I was so concerned. You know, it's like the first time I wore a short skirt or the first time I wore shorts, you know, you feel like, oh my God, this is such a big deal. Literally nobody cares.
Yeah. But it probably has a very terrible impact on your mental state. And I even think sometimes, I think about myself, I was brought up with this stupid idea that even I as a man had to dress accordingly, and I couldn't wear shorts and all that stuff, you know. And it's summer, it's Germany, and everyone is walking around with shorts, but I can't. And so I was brought up with this, and I only started after leaving Islam. I started wearing shorts, you know, just letting my legs breathe outside. And I'm only a man, and I think, and that was so hard to do at first. And then I think, if I feel this way, how does a woman feel with this, with a veil on her head? It must be hell. Probably was.
It was really it's really difficult in the beginning. Yeah, you do feel. You do, you know, everything that you described. But I think that what's really hard to explain is how much it enters your psyche after you realize how controlled you were. So like one of my friends, he was Hasidic. He grew up in a Hasidic Jewish community, and he was never allowed to shave his beard. And when he left the community, he wants to get laser, in fact, I think he already did, get laser hair removal on his face. Because just when his beard starts to grow, it causes him like this PTSD. Yeah. Like he gets such anxiety over having this beard because he's like, no, fuck you. I will not have a beard because they forced him to have a beard. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's exactly what I was like in the winter months when everybody was wearing scarves around their neck or scarves around their head. There's no way I would freeze to death before I put anything around my neck because it just, the cloth being near my face reminded me of the hijab, and it legitimately gave me PTSD. I mean, we talk about the word triggered now like a joke, but that was literally triggering for me. Yeah. The day when I finally wore a scarf, like just a scarf around my neck, was a big deal because I felt like, wow, I've really healed a lot that I can actually wear a scarf without, you know, having a panic attack.
Yeah. I'm so glad we are over this. I'm so glad we are out. So glad we feel much better, much happier. So glad we can control ourselves now. We can take care of things as we like to, not as...
And so glad we can reach out and help others.
Yes, absolutely.
Because people say, why do you do this? Why are you saying this? Yeah. Why don't you just go live your life and be happy? And it's like, how can I? How selfish would that be, you know? Yeah. Like the quote on my Twitter feed is Toni Morrison, where she says, the function of freedom is to free someone else. If we can't use our lives to help other people, then all of everything that we've gone through would just be wasted.
It is also a very basic human thing. I mean, we have come out of this, we have tasted the freedom, we have tasted how good it feels. We are, we feel the pain of how painful it was to be stuck in that. And the most basic thing we want to do is to spread this to others and to let them know that there is a better world.
Mm-hmm.
It's so simple, you know. So telling us that we should just go and live our lives is very, it doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
So I would, tell everyone, this is an amazing book, very well written, shocking, emotional, very revealing, very unveiled. I would suggest go buy this book, order it on Amazon. I will put the links below in the pinned comment and the description. You can find it there. Please get this, read it through, leave a review on Amazon or wherever you got it. And tell us what you thought. And yeah, awesome. One final thing before I want to let you go is you dedicated this book to someone, you said, to a friend.
Yeah, that's my friend Tiffany, who 9 years ago yesterday passed away. Yeah, the book is dedicated to her. She is essentially the person that allowed me to unveil myself. She was, you know, who I'm trying to be to all these people out in the world right now. She was that person to me. So she was the one that reached through to me and let me know there's happiness, there's freedom. You know, you don't have to live like this. And that's basically, I want to follow in her example and do that for other people and just let them know that you don't have to live like this, that there is freedom and there is happiness and you deserve it.
That is great. That is great. Well, thank you. All right. Yasmin, you are amazing to talk to. I really enjoy this. I hope I will have you on again in the future, most definitely. Anything else you want to add?
No, this was perfect. Thank you so much for having me, and I look forward to coming again. And congratulations on this channel, and thanks again for allowing me to be your very first guest. It's been an honor.
It's an honor on my side. Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone. I'll see you again in a different episode with someone else. If you want me to talk to anyone specific, you can let me know always in the comment section. You can let me know what you thought of this conversation. And please free yourselves, please value your freedom, please value the freedoms of others, please help us free more minds and more people. And as always, thanks and stay away from Islam.
I forgot you say that at the end.